that shaped a lot of who I am now because I read into things.
The good thing is that Trent, being an artist, you know, respects the artist's point of view. He happens to be the only person in the music industry that I trust.
And I think rock bands are out of fashion generally, you know, these days. I don't give a shit. It all becomes one thing where we can kind of make sense. It's therapy. It's also a way of trying to come to terms with a world that makes less sense, it seems, as the days go on. I listened to Pink Floyd The Wall a million times and reading everything I could into, detecting there were certain lyrics that weren't on the album that were in the liner notes. But that kind of blank canvas allowed me to read into it what I wanted it to be to me.
Other thing about this show is that almost nothing about it is premeditated. I mean, it was put together really fast. We just spent all our effort in actually working on the music that we really want to play. And it's that kind of show. I mean, the dynamic of it is really, in a way, masculine, and it's really stripped down.
This is what it is. You may not like it. That's fine. You don't need... There's plenty of other options for you, you know? It's not gonna hurt my feelings to say I don't like Nine Inch Nails. Fine, you know?
Welcome to the Discographers Podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Tyler, and with me I have an actual freaking wizard, Brian.
How's it going, Tyler?
Pretty good. So what are we talking about this month, Brian?
Well, this month we're going to be talking about Nine Inch Nails' third major release, the 1994 full-length album, The Downward Spiral.
So, Brian, last week you mentioned that The Downward Spiral is your least favorite Nine Inch Nails album. Do you want to kind of go into a little bit about that?
Yeah. No, I've got some reasons, which I, of course, feel are valid, but feel free to crucify me for them. One of the main reasons that this is probably my least favorite record, and understand when I say that, I like this record a lot. It's just my least favorite record from Nine Inch Nails. I feel like one of the largest contributing factors to that is that a lot of the best lyrical work on this album, a lot of the best lyrics are hidden underneath copious amounts of vocal distortion, to the point where you could not, in the course of listening to the song, actually pick out the words unless you were reading the lyrics as you listened to it. And I feel like that does a serious disservice to some really, really well-written lyrics from Trent.
I mean, so obviously that's going to be intentional, you know, an intentional artistic choice.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that that is to encourage re-listens and maybe listening with the booklet in front of you with the lyrics? And so you just have to kind of sit down and focus on the following along with the lyrics?
I think there may be at least an element of that, but I do want to say that from my standpoint as a listener, specifically with this album, some of these lines are so powerfully obfuscated by the filtering and the arrangement that even though I am aware of what the lyrics are, I still cannot pick them out. After years and years and years of listening to this record, I have a hard time syncing up what my ears are hearing in a rather aggressive mess of sound with the lyrics that I'm seeing printed on the page. And that for me detracts from the experience of listening to this record in particular. Now, that's a completely subjective opinion.
Yeah, I agree with that, because I've been listening to this album for almost, 20 years. In general, I know Nine Inch Nails lyrics, like I can sing along in my car, but this album has a lot of sections where I'm going, more than you'll ever know, kind of a thing. So
yeah.
If you
want to try singing along to the pre-choruses of The Ruiner, good luck.
Yes.
For me, this album, more than honestly any other Nine Inch Nails release, steps over the line of accessibility a little farther than the rest of them, right? Like, it challenges mm-hmm. you more. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but his songs are very challenging in other ways, and I didn't feel like they needed that added level of difficulty. But that's probably because I'm a piece of plebeian scum.
Well, aren't we all? Another thing with this album, Brett, is it's a concept album.
Yes, and that's one of the things I like about this album. For those who aren't familiar with the term, a concept album is an album which revolves around a single theme or a central story. Perhaps the most famous examples would be maybe Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon or The Who's Tommy. Dark Side of the Moon's a good example of a theme-based concept album, but Tommy's also a very good example of a story-based concept album.
There's one thing that I've noticed with Nine Inch Nails fans specifically.
Mm-hmm.
I would argue that almost every album Trent Reznor has done, or Nine Inch Nails has done, is a concept album.
To varying degrees, I think that's very true.
Oh, and Trent doesn't always say it before the album is coming out. But a lot of people are always trying to tie the concept together, but almost more kind of like what you said. There's the theme, there's a concept theme, and then there's also a concept like plot story. Like, here's the story of Steve and his awesome day or whatever. I think a lot of people try to connect. I think all of the albums are concept. Will share a unifying theme, and then people always try and struggle to connect, tie it together as a plot. It's something that I've noticed over the years.
Yeah. I think this is maybe one of two in his catalog that are more story based. I think the rest of them are thematic, but I feel like whether it was the intention or not, they're all pretty concept. The interesting thing about that dichotomy between a theme or story-based concept album is that Trent sort of did both with Downward Spiral, using the story of the main character's journey to rock bottom as a framework to explore the different themes from the viewpoint of a single character. And it's not something I feel like I've seen done very often, and I feel like it's a unique artistic achievement.
Yeah, definitely. And then there's one other thing that I kind of thought was interesting that ties a lot of the tracks together is the what people call the downward spiral motif.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows up through several of the songs, of kind of a cool little thing that ties some of the songs together within the album.
Absolutely. And, you know, I've read up on the downward spiral motif, and I feel like in some cases when people say that the motif is present in a certain song, they're reaching a little bit. Right, like they're like, well, there's one bit of musical similarity, and therefore, you know, and the idea with a motif in music being that it's a repeated theme, right? Like, and that doesn't necessarily need to mean that you're playing the exact same melody every time. You know, it's a really common technique in like film composition for soundtracks and in classical songs to use a motif. But the only two songs on this album that actually use the quote-unquote downward spiral motif in their entirety are Closer and The Downward Spiral. It's that bum 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 bum. Right? And that's the actual full motif. And it gets used in those two songs. But portions of it get used in other songs, right? So, like, there's little snatches here and there that sort of remind you of it, even if maybe they're doing it by a different musical device. But in its own way, that does function as a motif. I just feel like sometimes people can get out of hand with saying that it's present in every song, because it's not. But it is a nice through line.
Yeah, much like the people who try and connect, try and say that every album is a plot. Concept.
Because every album does, Tyler.
Every single one.
Well, I just want to conclude this by saying that my favorite Nine Inch Nails concept album is A Night at the Opera by Queen. So now's the part of the episode where we hand it over to Tyler to give us a take on the history of what was going on with Trent in the band at the time of this recording. So, Tyler, what do you got?
In the early 90s, things were falling into place for Trent Reznor. He was a Grammy-winning artist. He was signed to a major label that promised not to interfere with his work. He had discovered, befriended, and signed Brian Warner, aka Marilyn Manson, to his Nothing Records sub-label. He was producing Warner's first album, Portrait of an American Family, and he had a vision for Nine Inch Nails' second album. He set up shop in a Beverly Hills mansion that he dubbed La Pig. This was the house where the followers of Charles Manson's cult brutally murdered Sharon Tate, her unborn child, and four others. The cult members famously wrote Pig on the front door of the mansion, but Reznor denied knowing any of this until after he had christened the house La Pig and had finished recording The Downward Spiral there. When it came time to write the album, Reznor wanted to break away from Broken's singular sound and themes of anger. He stated, "Thematically, I wanted to explore the idea of somebody who systematically throws or uncovers every layer of what he is surrounded with. Comfort-wise, from personal relationships to religion to questioning the whole situation. Someone dissecting his own ability to relate to other people or have anything to believe in. With The Downward Spiral, I tried to make a record that had a full range. Rather than a real guitar-based record or a real synth-based record, I tried to make it something that opened the palette for Nin, so we don't get pigeonholed. It was a conscious effort to focus more on texture and space, rather than bludgeoning you over the head for an hour with a guitar." Reznor cited David Bowie's album Low as a songwriting inspiration, saying, "I related to it on a songwriting level, a mood level, and a song structure level." While he still preferred to be the sole member of Nin, Reznor brought in Stephen Perkins of Jane's Addiction to record drum tracks, Adrian Belew, who worked out with Frank Zappa, David Bowie, and the Talking Heads for guitar. Reznor recorded himself and others play long segments, and then cut them down to short samples that would be rearranged on the final tracks. Layered with metaphors that leave things to interpretation, The Downward Spiral is a concept album where the protagonist is dealing with religion, dehumanization, violence, disease, society, drugs, sex, and finally suicide. Reznor has stated that the character is a representation of himself during touring. He began to use drugs and alcohol to escape from the pressures of the tour, media, and the record label. He later said, "It was during that tour that problems started to arise. Prior to that, I would have considered myself pretty normal. With The Downward Spiral, I can remember where I was in my head, what I was thinking, and I can remember writing that record and the mindset. This record that was about an extension of me became the truth fulfilling itself." Nin's popularity spiked even further after the band played on the mud-soaked stage of Woodstock 1994. Nin also caught the attention of David Bowie himself. Bowie was planning a tour for his latest album, Outside. His idea was to co-headline with Nine Inch Nails in the hopes of a cross-pollinization of the fan bases. Bowie and Reznor came up with an unconventional tour. As Nine Inch Nails near the end of their set, Bowie's band would slowly come on stage. Reznor and Bowie shared vocal duties as the merged band would play a mix of Nine Inch Nails and Bowie songs and end the tour with a duet of The Downward Spiral's final track, Hurt. Reznor was a fan of Bowie as a teenager, and so when Bowie reached out to him, it was a huge honor. Bowie's influence grew into Reznor's personal life as well. After Bowie's death in 2016, Reznor wrote about that time with Bowie. "On that tour, I was a mess, quite honestly. It was the peak of Nine Inch Nails' newfound rocket ship of fame. It distorted my personality and became overwhelming. Going from not being able to afford a gas bill to show up to arenas full of people who think they kind of know you. The line starts to blur between the guy on stage and the person you used to be. My way of dealing with life was to numb myself with drugs and alcohol because it made me feel better and more equipped to deal with everything. My career was skyrocketing, but the scaffolding that was holding me up as a person was starting to collapse. But I knew in my heart that I was on an unsustainable, reckless, and self-destructive path. When I met David, he had been through that. He was content. He was at peace with himself, with an incredible wife, clearly in love. There were a number of times where the two of us were alone, and he said some things that weren't scolding, but pieces of wisdom that stuck with me. You know, there's a better way here, and it doesn't have to end in despair or in death." Next time, Reznor takes on a new album with an even larger scope, but can he sustain his drug and alcohol-fueled lifestyle? And to
So, I need to start out this month with a quick correction. Last time, I said that the frequency of a tritone was directly in between the frequencies of two notes an octave apart. It is actually the note just under the one that is directly halfway between the octaves. I was speaking very generally, and I realized afterwards that it was unclear. So, there you go. Okay, so music theory time. Let's talk about rhythm. There's a lot of math in music. Now, you don't need to be aware of the math to enjoy the music, but it definitely helps in understanding it. Like I said in our first episode, rhythm is the measure of the spacing and duration of notes. There is an accepted language for describing the duration of notes. For instance, you have the quarter note. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Or the half note. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Or you have the whole note. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now you'll notice that each of those notes is twice as long as the last. There are shorter notes as well. So let's go back to the quarter note. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then you have the eighth note. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. And then you have the 16th note. 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a. And just for fun, the 32nd note. Now you probably noticed that I had a specific pattern for counting each of those notes, and those are the generally accepted ways to do it. You can have normal rhythms, which use the numbered beats. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. Or you can have syncopated rhythms, which do not place notes in the numbered beats. So 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. Changing between these notes in various combinations is one of the basic things that gives a song its unique sound. Think We Will Rock You. 1 and 2, 3 and 4. 1 and 2, 3 and 4. Or My Sharona. 1 and 2 and 3, 4. 1, 2, 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3, 4. 1, 2, 3 and 4. Or A Whole Lot of Love. 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a e and. Or even closer. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. But we'll come back to that. Another aspect of a song's rhythm is its time signature. Now, you've probably seen these on a piece of sheet music before. They're usually at the beginning of the first line and are written like a fraction, in most cases a 4 over another 4. Now, this is by far the most common time signature, so much so that in some circles it's referred to as common time. It's usually just referred to as 4-4. The way a time signature works is that the bottom number tells you what kind of note is equal to one beat. So in 4-4, the bottom 4 indicates that a quarter note is a beat. 1, 2, 3, 4. Like fractions, 1/4 is equal to 1/4. In other time signatures, such as the also common 6-8, the 8 on the bottom indicates that the 8th note, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and, is one beat. The top number tells you how many beats are in one measure. A measure is the basic rhythmic building block of a song. On sheet music, you will see several vertical lines or bars dividing the horizontal lines of the music. These show you where each measure ends. So a song in 4-4 has a measure that is 4/4 notes long. You can put notes other than quarter notes into the measure, but they will need to add up to the length of 4/4 notes. For instance, you could have 8/8 notes in a measure of 4-4. A measure of 6/8 would need to add up to the length of 6/8 notes, and so on. This is the method that the musical community has used to describe the rhythm of a song for centuries. Take, for example, this song in the 3-4 time signature by Johann Strauss II, the Blue Danube Waltz. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Some songs use less common time signatures to give a more unique feel, such as Dave Brubeck Quartet's Take 5, which is in 5-4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. Or the Foo Fighters song Times Like These, which has a bridge in 7-4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. Many musicians will actually break these down into smaller numbers for ease of counting, the way that I did in those examples. On Downward Spiral, Trent used some strange time signatures to give the songs a more unbalanced feel, which really serves the lyrics very, very well. And with all of that being said, let us finally move on to the review of the Downward Spiral. Let's jump right in. The album starts out with Mr. Self-Destruct. The song begins with a modified sample of a man being beaten from George Lucas's directorial debut film, THX 1138. This is the first of several samples from the films on this record, and Trent primarily used them as rhythmic texture. The song explores various aspects of the human psyche, and it is sort of a prologue to the story of the record, setting the stage for the internal struggle which incites the main character's downward spiral. Musically, the song has some Nin hallmarks, such as the extreme dynamic change between the bridge and the rest of the song, the repeated lyrics with building dynamics during the bridge, and the use of a vague blues scale for the vocals, which are sometimes major and sometimes minor. It also makes use of syncopation in the bass line in the bridge. The song ends with some looping clips of Adrian Belew playing some extremely chaotic guitar. If you think of the album as being a sort of essay, then this song would be the thesis, and it seems to say quite a lot right up front. So, moving on to the next song, Piggy, which is built on a loosely swung drum groove, which is a new feel for Nin. Where the rhythms are usually very tight and often robotic, this one has a more fluid feel to it. The song also features the only time that Trent played an actual acoustic drum kit on a record. He has used drum machines and played drums via keyboard on many occasions, but nearly never played a real drum kit. It was apparently a happy accident where they recorded Trent sound checking the drum kit, and he liked the sound so much that they left it in. The song ends with a descending piano riff which sounds slightly similar to the one used in Closer later on. It is in a scale which is like a Mixolydian scale, but the sixth note is flat. Hear the difference? As a result, the riff starts out sounding very minor and then takes an unexpected major turn on the last note. The next track, Heresy, deals with the character's disillusionment with religion, and it starts off with a synth riff that does sort of an audible illusion. The second note of the riff is louder or more accented than the first, giving the impression that that is where the downbeat or pulse of the song is. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. This impression is broken when the drums arrive, lined up with the first synth note rather than the second. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. The vocals in the verse are recorded with a heavy filtering on one side and a more normal sound on the other. It sounds unbalanced and sinister, and it lends a creepy energy to the lyrics, which fits very well.
The choruses make way for distorted, screamed vocals and a gargantuan guitar riff, which is so distorted that it can be hard to make out the notes. For those who listen to the Broken episode, the riff starts on a tritone, then climbs down a minor scale. It is very much in line with the metal music of the time, but it sounds great. The next song is March of the Pigs, and it is one of the most memorable songs on the record. The verses are in an odd time signature. They're in 7-4. For three measures, and then every third measure it switches to two measures of 4-4. When you add it all up, the total feels like 29-4. 1-2-3-4. Now, this sounds surprisingly natural because he shouts a word on the first beat of every 7-4 measure, so you can't miss the downbeat. He then brings in the two normal measures of 4-4 to help give the audience something familiar to hold on to, if only for a moment. The chorus is comprised of a descending synth bass line in a Locrian scale, note the tritone, and two different rhythmic, non-musical sounds on the left and right channels. They alternate in their timing, giving the feeling of rapid breathing between the two sides of the recording. The chorus ends with a deliberately cheesy piano riff, which nicely underlines the biting sarcasm of the lyrics. The thoughts in it make you feel better. This riff is in the same modified Mixolydian scale from the end of Piggy, which is called the Mixolydian flat 6 scale. And as such, it ends major when you would normally expect a minor. It is a bizarre moment of comfort in the middle of an onslaught of weaponized guitars. After a brief pause to catch your breath, the verse bursts back to life in yet another extreme dynamic change, leading to the final chorus, and then the song ends with a big extended blues chord on piano. The chord is a D7 sharp 9, and it's notable for containing both the major and minor notes of the chord, so it has an ambiguous sound. The same type of chord is actually used in the verses of Purple Haze by Jimi Hendrix. And now the song voted to be most likely first Nin song you ever heard. Closer. Musically, this song plays a lot more like his synth-pop songs, but if they were slowed down significantly. The beat is simple and repetitive, with a heavily modified kick drum, sampled from the Iggy Pop song, Nightclubbing. The bass line is in a Locrian scale with a funky syncopated rhythm on a heavy synth bass. You let me desecrate you. Normally a funk bass line would be played in a minor scale, and this is a great example of taking something familiar and tweaking it just enough to make it interesting. The harmonies in the pre-chorus feature a tritone, which paves the way for a tritone used as the third chord of the chorus. When the second verse arrives, a new ascending synth part comes in, which is in the same flat 6 Mixolydian scale as Piggy and March of the Pigs. Which helps the verse sound a bit more vague in terms of being major or minor. This tactic is an old standby for Trent at this point. The bridge changes keys and then slowly layers in a guitar which gravitates around the original key, which makes the transition back to the original key for the outro all the more satisfying. In the outro, a more aggressive synth riff in the flat 6 Mixolydian scale carries the song to its conclusion, with the famous descending piano riff that sprinkles itself throughout the album. This song hides complexity behind an accessible front, both in the music and the lyrics, and it is, in my opinion, one of Trent's best written songs. The next track, Ruiner, starts with an early Brooklyn hip-hop style beat. And Trent singing along to a simple bouncy synth part. The pre-choruses introduce a great deal more distortion to the drum sound, and then also feature Trent providing some more or less hidden lyrics that are also extremely distorted. When the chorus lands, you are blasted with synthesized trumpets playing in the now familiar flat 6 Mixolydian scale. Synthesized trumpets are something that Trent would visit again on the next record, so stay tuned. He also used an interesting technique here where he put the vocals more in the left ear than the right during the choruses, which makes it easier to hear them over the ocean of synth and guitar taking up the middle of the recording. The bridge of this song also features one of Trent's only honest-to-God guitar solos. He apparently recorded this half as a joke, using a preset on a cheap guitar pedal, but everyone liked it so much it made the cut, much like the drums in Piggy. The Becoming makes use of an alternating time signature, one measure of 7/8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, followed by a measure of 6/8, giving the general impression of 13/8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. The scale of the bass line is almost Locrian, but it isn't really following any hard and fast rules. The vocals are mostly major, occasionally drifting minor for emphasis. The bridge of the song is in 6/8 and features a clean electric guitar with one microphone on the amplifier and the other on the actual strings of the electric guitar. This is an unconventional technique, which he would later revisit on Only. This song stands out to me as one of Trent's better vocal performances on the record, with a very controlled but emotive sound, a wide vocal range, and providing himself with a choir-like background vocal in the bridge. Next up is I Do Not Want This, which features another audible allusion in the opening drum beat. In most popular music, the snare drum is reserved for the backbeat. The backbeat, for example, when in 4/4, would mean that the snare is only on the second and fourth beats. Think We Will Rock You, and you've got the right idea. This beat starts with the snare on the first beat, giving the impression that the kick drum that follows the first two snare hits is the actual first beat, or downbeat, of the measure. This is further reinforced by the fact that the piano begins at the same time as the kick drum, on the and of the first beat. This illusion is broken when the chorus starts on the true first beat of the measure with a snare. A piano supplements the verses with a tritone heavy riff, which is the main harmonic device of the song until the overwhelmingly metal guitar of the choruses takes over the job. There is some odd production at work here, with what sounds like very heavily filtered white noise taking on an important rhythmic role in the back half of the song. Stay inside my bed. The end of the song features another instance of Trent repeating a phrase as a song gains intensity. And like many tracks on the album, it ends abruptly. Moving on to Big Man with a Gun, which employs the same rhythmic trickery as I Do Not Want This, with a drum beat beginning with a snare. Once again, this illusion is broken at the chorus when the background vocals sing, "Shoot, shoot, shoot, shoot," in time with the snare. This is an example of Trent intentionally upsetting expectations you may have as a listener developed from years of listening to the more traditional music. This is one of the most chaotic tracks on the album, but also one of the simplest from a theory standpoint. On the other hand, A Warm Place is the most peaceful and serene track on the album. It is built mostly around layers and layers and layers of gentle synthesizers in a very normal major scale. It makes use of delay or echo on the high-strummed guitars at the beginning, along with the main synth melody. The main melody has a similar tone to the warbling piano at the end of Closer, but a very different melody. It is connected, but separate. The song marks a turning point in the record, one last deep breath before the final plunge. And into the home stretch, we begin with Eraser. This song starts with recordings of Trent breathing through the mouthpiece of a saxophone meant to sound like the rubbing of erasers. The song is in 6-4, which is different from 6-8, in that it lacks the swing sound of 6-8, favoring a halting sound that's more like 1.5 measures of 4-4, which it basically is. The song builds methodically for a few minutes, until the lyrics begin. During this time, there's a guitar part that is haunting and beautiful. It accomplishes this sound by making use of both the major and minor notes, followed by bending between the tritone and the fifth, which offers alternating tension and release. This effect is greatly increased when the riff is given a healthy dose of reverb partway through the build, which allows it to fill more of the space of the song. The melody of the verses dances up and down a minor scale in time with the piano. Once the chorus digs in, things change drastically. The time signature switches to 4-4, and the vocal melody stays on one high note, and the guitars have chainsaw-level distortion. Songwriters often refer to songs like this as growers because they don't follow the repeating up and down structure of most pop songs. They can be difficult to get right, as repetition is a part of what makes a song memorable in the first place. Especially in a 5-minute song like this, it can also be tough to maintain the interest of the listener, as songs like these can be perceived to be developing too slowly. Trent manages to do both by keeping the lyrics simple but impactful and adding elements to the arrangement just before your attention would start to wander. He doesn't give you time to get bored. In short, this is a difficult song, executed perfectly. Reptile starts off with some very mechanical samples and a misleadingly delicate synth. Which lulls you into a false sense of security until the truly bombastic drums begin. The drums are part drum kit and part sample. One note of that sample sounds a bit out of time because it is a triplet. A triplet is a rhythmic concept wherein three notes are crammed into the space that two usually occupy. It gives a halting, raw feeling to the beat, which is otherwise very tight and sterile. The verses are sort of modal or droning, and by that I mean that the bass note remains the same, with Trent's vocals moving around that note in different scales as needed, all revolving around that same tone center, that same root note. She leaves the trail of me, show me where she's been. The choruses are notable for playing two huge guitar chords, but not playing the root chord afterward to bring a sense of resolution, as would be typical in a rock song. This resolution instead comes from Trent singing the root note, and a synthesizer playing another note from the chord. This is a surprising display of restraint and subtlety in what otherwise sounds like a relentlessly heavy song. The interlude uses a very echoey, reverby guitar riff, which alternates between a tritone and the root note. Just for good measure, I guess. The second verse introduces a guitar riff that functions similarly to the vocals, in as much as it doesn't necessarily imply any chord movement, but instead explores the area around the root chord. After the second chorus, the song takes a brief step backward to provide the last verse with a little bit more punch. It sort of gets a running start. The last verse is instrumental and combines both of the guitar riffs used previously, before giving way to one more chorus to send the song off. And now we have arrived at what many would argue is the end of the story, the downward spiral. Here we see the main character contemplating and potentially following through with killing himself. The song starts with the downward spiral motif from the end of Closer, played in a lower key, on a guitar, very slowly. It is haunting and brings a sense of finality to the story, as sort of a bookend. More guitars later join and are bending in and out of tune around a simple bass line, setting a tone of imbalance. The rest of the song is mostly delivered in spoken word through a thick, low-pass filtered haze of instrumental noise and screams. It's almost more of a poem set to a soundscape than a song. The vocals are slightly obscured, inviting you to listen very closely. It is dark and unsettling, as the almost victorious background music is intertwined with some of the darkest thoughts possible. It's not a happy Hollywood ending. It's unclear and provocative by design, and it is a deranged but effective piece of storytelling. So, if The Downward Spiral, the last track, was the end of the story, then Hurt would be the epilogue. I hurt myself today. It is desperately sad, but beautifully redemptive, and the music once again perfectly underlines the lyrics. The verses describe the character's struggles in crushing detail. The music is mostly in a Dorian scale, except that the first chord is a minor at 11 chord, which is a very weird one. You may have heard of the phrase a diminished chord, and that's basically like a chord that is extra minor. The thing about a minor at 11 chord is that it has two notes right next to each other, one from a minor chord and one from a diminished chord. It's sort of both. So put another way, if a minor chord is sad and a diminished chord is depressed, the minor add 11 chord would be kind of right in between. It lines up nicely with the exceedingly dark lyrics of the verse. Now the choruses switch to a more standard sort of key and scale, and they make use of a very familiar chord progression, which can be heard in almost every sad pop song ever. This is the most normal chord progression that Trent has used at any point in this album, and because of that, it has almost limitless emotional impact. After living a lifetime of hearing pop music, we are hardwired to react to this progression, and it makes the chorus one of the most earnest and emotionally powerful pieces that Trent has ever written, because he waited till the end of the album to give you something this familiar. The song follows a familiar pop structure as well. The verse, chorus, verse, chorus, and another chorus. The structure and composition offer the listener almost zero challenges other than strange production and the minor add 11 chords, which both sound familiar even by the end of the first verse. As a result, the lyrics and melody of the song are given full control of your heartstrings, with only enough distractions to keep the song interesting. It ends with three huge guitar chords and a tritone that just seems to drone on forever, just to make sure you don't leave the album feeling too positive. I could go on and on about this one, but suffice it to say, I feel that it is one of the best songs ever written by anyone. I feel like a song has two jobs: tell a story and make you feel something. And I have a hard time thinking of a song that delivers so well on both tasks. And that's the end of the record. It's a record that shows Trent taking his newfound mainstream acclaim and pushing it to its stylistic extremes, daring the listener to come along for the ride. It is wildly experimental, stepping into brand new musical territory for the band, and it is, in every sense of the word, ambitious. It's an incredible artistic achievement, and I feel that its greatest strength is also its greatest weakness, which is that it happened when it did. Trent was relentlessly exploring and growing as an artist, and had not yet found the level of finesse he would later find in some of his more challenging techniques. But if you have any reservations about this record, go listen to later live recordings of these songs, and you will be floored how the power of these songs grew along with Trent's prowess as a performer. Next month, we'll take a look at my favorite Nine Inch Nails record. And thus concludes my review of The Downward Spiral. Now, we've heard at this point more than enough of what I think about it, but Tyler, tell me your thoughts on the album.
I think we've established that I like the album as a whole better than you, I guess. Is that what we're saying?
I think that's fair.
I don't want to put words in your mouth.
Well, no, you're right.
I guess for me, I like something, you know, this works for a book, a movie, TV show, painting, I guess. Just I like something that tells a story.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I really enjoy, is the story could be just one song, or it could be a through line through all the songs like we have here. When you have a concept album and the ideas are very clear, or at least somewhat clear, where you know, okay, this is somebody who's literally having a downward spiral into all this chaos, I don't know, that makes a connection for me.
I definitely hear that. And I mean, not to be argumentative, I think my biggest gripe is that because of how good the story is, the issues that I have with, you know, the sort of hidden lyrics, you know, the art sacrifices the story in some instances. Mm-hmm. And I think that's maybe part of my contention with this album. But at the end of the day, it does tell a damn good story, and it's a really, really well-recorded and executed album.
And I think this is more of a mature concept, if I get me to stop saying the word concept this for this podcast. But there's definitely a lot of influences from, like, David Bowie is a big influence for this album. And kind of growing up a little bit in terms of what the sound is going to be like, where the last couple have been just kind of just focusing negative energy on people he didn't like, whereas this one is more of a wider range.
Yeah, I think that's true of both the lyrics and the music. Like the lyrics cover a much broader range of issues than the first two albums combined. And the music becomes a lot more artistically adventurous in many ways.
Yeah, you have a lot of the loud, angry, and then you have some quieter moments to kind of let some of that sink in and give you some time with your own thoughts during the album. One interesting thing about The Downward Spiral is this is one of the only time that we get to hear demos of tracks that were on The Downward Spiral in their, like, unfinished form. Trent, he's very meticulous about, he wants to work on something and then present it as in its completed form. And, you know, and then that's it. Like, that's, he gives you the album on a tray and says, this is The Downward Spiral. This is all you need. You know, there might be B-sides or something, but they're usually covers or, you know, remixes.
And they're often a completed, finished, fully mixed and mastered song.
Exactly. So this is, I think this is a one of those times where the studio stepped in, and because for the 20th anniversary re-release, they packaged in, you know, a bunch of those B-sides, a couple covers, some remixes, and then there were three demos for Ruiner, Reptile, and Heresy, and I think that's the kind of thing that I feel like was done without Trent's permission.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that would make some sense. There were some really, really good B-sides that you know didn't make their way to the public till much later on, like Memorabilia and Burn. Or a couple of really, really good songs on the B-side.
Yeah, I really like Burn.
I mean, my first exposure to Burn was when they played it live on the Beside You in Time DVD. And I was like, what is this and why have I never heard it? Why is this so good?
Yeah, I think it's definitely better. It's best form when it's live and it's got the full visceralness.
Oh, very much agreed. Very much agreed.
The Downward Spiral is one of the only albums that Nine Inch Nails has played live, like, from start to finish.
Yeah, I guess it is.
Yeah, there were two nights where they played The Downward Spiral from start to finish. And so those are one of the times where there was a relaxed film and recording policy. So one of those nights, fans were able to record it. And so we have, as fans, the Downward Spiral live
as recorded by fans with presumably high quality cameras.
Yes. The fan recording set thing is something that I plan to touch on later on. So a little teaser for that,
for sure.
For that section. Do we want to jump into talking about the album track by track and kind of talk about the plot, the concept?
Yeah,
plot
absolutely. You may have noticed in listening to my essay that I was not talking much about the lyrics at all. And that's because we figured with me covering every song in that section that it would get a little boring if it was about an hour of me talking about this record. And maybe it would be a little bit more engaging to have Tyler involved with that discussion, because I can assure you he has some prescient things to say about this record.
Well, no pressure for me. But yeah, definitely an hour of two of us talking about it is going to be better than an hour of just one of us talking about it. So the first song is Mr. Self-Destruct.
Yeah, Mr. Self-Destruct is it's a hell of a way to start a record.
So I always saw Mr. Self-Destruct as kind of like basically Trent saying, all right, here is the tone of the album. Here's, you know, and if you look at it, you know, in the lyrics, here, you know, it's kind of him saying, all right, here's some of the concepts. Here are some of the ideas that I'm going to touch on. I'm going to touch on some religion. I'm going to touch on some sex, some violence. You know, kind of here's the downward spiral in compressed into one song, preparing us for what we're about to hear.
Yeah, in very much the way that when you're writing a college essay, you start out with a thesis stating your point and then expound upon it. That's sort of the function that this song performs. The way I've seen it is that, and you know, that this is obviously open to interpretation, but it seems like it's sort of an examination of Sigmund Freud's concept of the id, the ego, and the superego, where the id represents your most instinctual urges, and the superego is your conscience, and the ego is the mediator, you know, which is the part of your psyche that interacts with reality. And I guess to put it another way, when you're at the bar, your id wants four more beers. Your superego knows that you'll hate yourself in the morning if you do, so your ego compromises on two more beers and closes out the tab. And this song has four verses that seem to kind of go back and forth from the perspectives of the id and the superego, and the choruses sort of describe the struggle that the ego has being torn between the two of them. And that's the way that I've seen this. But I'm sure this song is open to many other forms of interpretation.
Yeah, we should probably say that at the top, where this, you know, really any time that we're talking about our interpretations, it's really like, it's literally just our interpretations of it. Trent definitely has, for all of his music, I'm sure, has what it means exactly to him. And he's always been very cagey about what every song means exactly.
Oh yeah, he dodges that question like a boxer.
Yeah, so it's definitely there. Trent has an idea and he puts it out there, but it's up to us to how we interpret it, how we decide to handle that. There are definitely people who think very different than what I think. You know, Brian, you might think that something's different than what I think. And for the most, we're probably all correct to some degree, and we're all wrong to another degree. So, you know, just keep that in mind when we're talking about how we feel.
Yeah, and what I'll say is to borrow a line from Reese Roper, this is what we think the songs mean, and if you have another opinion about it, it's probably better. Yours is probably better.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it.
So in the bridge of Mr. Self-Destruct, he starts repeating the phrase, "You let me do this to you." And it seems like that's casting guilt or blame on the character of the album himself. Since even though the song seems to be, in my view, a fight between the id, the ego, and the superego, those are all part of the same person. So regardless what part of you is pulling you in whatever direction, it's still kind of your fault. It's this weird shame spiral thing that's going on. And I think it's an interesting way to start it off.
So the next track we have is Piggy.
Yeah, Piggy seems to be a declaration, right? So we've had sort of the prologue in Mr. Self-Destruct, and this seems to be the character starting off on his journey. And he's fed up with the struggle between his id and his superego, and he repeats the phrase, "Nothing can stop me now because I don't care anymore." He seems determined to cast off his superego and live a life unimpeded by conscience and religious morality. And this is the first of many, many times he uses the phrase, "Nothing can stop me now," over his career.
Yeah, that's one thing that we'll start to talk about more and more, is the repeating of, there's the callbacks to earlier works. And so this is kind of the setup for that.
Yeah, this is definitely, this is the first time that he's used that line, but oh, he will get his money's worth out of it.
So while we're talking about Piggy, mm-hmm. One thing that definitely jumps out to me in this album as a whole is there's a lot of swine references there, you know, because we have the song Piggy, we have another song coming up, March of the Pigs. Mm-hmm. There's a brief mention in Heresy, I believe, you know, where there's swine is mentioned again.
Yeah. And then also keeping the flock in line, which is not necessarily pigs, but yeah.
I mean, I always saw that as sheep, but yeah, it could work as pigs.
Yeah. I mean, it's livestock.
Does Trent have some kind of weird pig fixation during this time? Like,
yeah. I mean,
it's just kind of weird.
He may have had some sort of interesting porcine fetish. It's a possibility. I mean, I think if you look at it from maybe a scientific point of view, right? I think You've watched Mythbusters. Everyone's watched Mythbusters. A lot of times when they need an analog for a human body, they will use a pig corpse, right? And maybe he's making some sort of allusion to the fact that at the end of the day, you know, while we may talk and, you know, have free will and blah, 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 we're still just animals. We're not that different from pigs.
We're still just meat.
Yeah, we're meat sacks. Exactly.
I hadn't actually thought about that way. Another couple pig references that aren't on the album itself, but during this time frame, I mentioned in my history that Trent Reznor set up shop in the Sharon Tate mansion where she was murdered by followers of Charles Manson. And one of the things they did before they left was to write the word pig in blood on the door. And supposedly Trent said that he didn't know about that. He didn't realize that that was the house until after the downward spiral was completed, kind of denying all knowledge of that. And then one other thing.
I remember reading that portion of interview, and it's funny. It seems like one of those things where a lot of the time, if someone were to say something like that in that context, it's oh, sure, a likely story. You're just trying not to seem like a jerk. But, like, he named the place, like, Pig Studios or something like that, didn't he?
Yeah, La Pig.
La Pig. There it is. La Pig. And part of me has a hard time believing that was on accident, but you know what? Maybe it was.
Yeah. He also says that he wrote Piggy well before the murder. He moved into that house. He had never known that he would be in that house. But yeah, I kind of lean towards it. There was some intent there, and, you know, just kind of tongue in cheek intent. And then afterwards, like, you know, there was a little bit of like
backlash,
backlash. And so he kind of like, oh, no, I didn't know anything about it. And then there one other, my last swine reference is the guitarist during this time, Richard Patrick, who later moved on to the lead singer and guitarist of Filter. Trent would nicknamed him Piggy. And so for the longest time, I know Richard Patrick thought that Piggy was about him. So Patrick left. And then, you know, the next album comes out by Trent, and it's one of the songs is called Piggy, which is his nickname. So he always kind of thought that it was about him.
Hard not to take it personally, I suppose, in that context. I wonder, though, if it's a literary allusion, right? Lord of the Flies. Ralph, the overweight kid in Lord of the Flies with the glasses, they would call him Piggy. I never really thought about that, but there actually seems to be like a little bit of that imagery, right? Where the actual, you know, the Lord of the Flies in the book was actually a pig's head that the kid sort of set up as an idol. God, that was a messed up book. But yeah, maybe there's some links there from a literary standpoint.
I'm done talking about pigs now.
I just want to put in for the record that I ate a Baconator for dinner. Wendy, sponsor this podcast, please.
Please, we need money.
I need more Baconators.
Moving on, the third track we have is Heresy, which is a very happy song.
Oh yeah, it's full of joy and hope. Heresy deals with the character's disillusionment with religion. It depicts him shedding the concept of a god and religion because of the hypocrisy he sees done in the name of said religion. And you know, this feels familiar from like Terrible Lie, but He sees it as strange, and we go back to that like id superego ego concept. You know, with religion being the superego used to, you know, basically allow self satisfying id driven behaviors. It seems like sort of an oxymoron. And so when he gets to the God is dead line in the chorus, it's actually a famous quote from Friedrich Nietzsche, the German philosopher. Showed up in a number of his works, and you know, that kind of falls in line with the German philosophy crush that Trent seemed to have at this particular point.
Yeah, I don't really have any thoughts. I mean, I feel like the song is very straightforward in its message and what it tries to get across.
It's not remarkably subtle.
Yeah, and doesn't need to be. One of the things I think that this album does is it breaks it down to, all right, here's my problem with religion, here's my problem with sex, here's my problem with violence. You know, if it kind of just takes, you know, we're going to take a moment to talk about sex. All right. And it does that. So yeah. It's very straightforward.
Absolutely. I think this song actually might be a big part of the reason that I don't like this album as much as some of the others. And it's funny because it's not the reason now, but at the time I when I first heard this record, I was very, very, very religious and am considerably less so now. But I think I just have some like lingering negative feelings about this song, even though I find myself agreeing with it more now, right? Because this song was challenging for me at that time. So that maybe that's part of the reason why.
Moving on, we have, we're not going to talk about pigs, but we're going to talk about the song March of the Pigs.
This is one that Trent has never, more so than other songs, has never really said what it is about. As far as I can tell, it's sort of a commentary on mob mentality. The whole thing seems to depict violently stampeding farm animals or, you know, a mosh pit. All the lyrics seem to describe the titular pigs acting solely upon id with no conscience. And, you know, the chorus ends with Trent being as sarcastic as I think he has ever been in a song with that, "Doesn't it make you feel better?" It feels so tongue-in-cheek, and I love it.
Yeah, definitely. I there might be some more sarcastic stuff that pops up later, but that's for another podcast. Next song we have is the big one, Closer.
So, Closer. Everyone's heard it. It's arguably Nin's most popular song, but I think people discount it as just being a dirty song about sex, which it is. But in the context of the it is. But in the context of the album's narrative, there is more to it. It shows a character who's deeply insecure and copes through aggressive sex. But it seems that whatever the level of dominance he asserts, he has a deep codependent need for the person he is dominating, as demonstrated by the nearly inaudible lyrics in the bridge, which read...
So, Brian, the lyrics that you're looking for are, "Through every forest, above the trees, within my stomach, scraped off my knees, I drink the honey inside your hive, you are the reason I stay alive."
Right, so he goes through this whole machismo thing, right, this whole dominance thing in the verses and the choruses, and he gets there, and that's like a desperate pleading for a connection with someone. I feel like he's actually only showing his cards there. But that's another example of a time where, in the album version, you can't hear those lyrics unless you're really listening for them.
Yes.
In plenty of live recordings, he brings those lyrics way more out front. And for me, it makes the song feel a lot more complete. And again, you know, that's me looking for some, you know, very simple, you know, resolution in songs. I like my songs to sort of be tied up in a bow a little bit because I'm a special little princess or whatever. But I feel like those are yes, I am. And I'm the prettiest princess. But I feel like those are some of the most poetic lyrics that he has on this entire record. Right. I feel like they are genuinely beautiful. And he's hiding them behind a wall of distortion. But I feel like, for me, they make the song. They're my favorite thing about the song, are those lyrics.
Listening on the radio, which I don't understand how this made it onto the radio and was so popular on the radio with all the censoring they had to do. My favorite part was always when it got to that, you know, the main chunk of lyrics was over and it was just everything, the music wash over you.
Yeah,
and just kind of fade out.
That song really takes its time ending, and I appreciate it for doing that. You know, it is one of the longest singles to hit radio airplay in that decade. I'm saying that with absolutely no sources. That's just based on remembrance and experience. So, you know, don't quote me on it. But it's interesting though when you talk about how this song plays into the narrative of the album with the whole, like, you know, the id, the superego, blah 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 blah. The last line of the chorus could be interpreted a couple of ways, right? That you get me closer to God. And one of those would be a familiar theme for Trent. It was touched on a lot on the first album, but it's sex is a religious experience, you know, with sex leading to, you know, transcendence and wholeness in a Buddhist kind of way. But the other would be more in the vein of a different German philosopher, Friedrich Nietzsche, who we mentioned earlier. and his concept of the Übermensch, or Superman. And the idea with that whole ideology being that if you rise above the traditional, you know, religious morals of your day, you can enforce your own morals on the world. But with the general idea behind Nietzsche's, you know, stuff there being that you would do that for the betterment of society. But that this is an idea that gets often perverted by young men who get a hold of it and see it as an excuse to shake off their superego in favor of their unrestricted id. An extreme example of that is the murder trial of Leopold and Loeb in 1924. Loeb believed that by committing acts of crime and violence, he could break his learned morality and allow himself to live an uninhibited life as a quote-unquote Übermensch. The truth is he was a sick, pathetic, manipulative guy, and it eventually culminated in him murdering a 14-year-old boy. And there's echoes of this ideology in the manifestos of many famously violent criminals, such as Eric Harris of the Columbine shootings, and you know, the guy from Virginia Tech. You know, there's pieces of this. But in this song, we see a more tame, normal human version of this, where it's depicting a sick, desperate man who's using the dominant sex to feel like he has control over a situation. And so in that case, you could interpret that last line as in, you get me closer to being a god, rather than physically closer to God. So, you know, it could be called the central theme of the album. And so, yes, it's a dirty hit radio single about sex, but it's also a nuanced, character-driven exploration of German philosophy. So there.
I feel like this is a great example of why I enjoy Nine Inch Nails.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's a lot of people have everyone's heard that I Want to Fuck You Like an Animal song. And they go, okay, that's Nine Inch Nails. I'm going to put that on the shelf. That's what that is defined now.
That's the box in my brain that's going into.
Yeah, exactly. And so, but then if you listen to, and so, you know, and everyone, the first time they hear it, they always hear just the, you know, I Want to Fuck You Like an Animal parts. And then, you know, you come back to it, and if you're really listening, you start to reveal all these deeper levels to this song, and I would argue, you know, most other Nine Inch Nails songs and Nine Inch Nails in general. So this is kind of why we do this podcast, is to kind of go, all right, so here's the top layer that everybody knows, and now we're going to rip that off, and we're going to show you what's some of the stuff that's underneath.
To quote Trent, take the skin and peel it back. Now, doesn't that make you feel better?
Yes, it does, Brian. Our next song is Ruiner.
Yeah, Ruiner is where I would say that Closer is probably one of Trent's best written songs. This one is not quite there. Trent's even said in interviews that he's not sure he got this one right, and I think I remember reading that this was a combination of two different song ideas, and it sort of sounds that way.
Yeah, it definitely does.
I guess the main fault I find with the song is the thing that I've already talked about, that it hides its best lyrics behind a metric ton of distortion. But it does serve an important purpose in the story of the album. The verses, they talk about, the pre-choruses talk about the Ruiner running around and wreaking havoc, and it seems like a metaphor for the consequences of his actions just kind of lurking in his subconscious. You know, maybe the idea with this one is, as disjointed as maybe it feels, maybe the verse's vaguely religious intonations and sort of feelings of betrayal are the superego, where the barely veiled sexual content in the chorus is the id, and then those sort of hidden lyrics are depicting that struggle.
One thing that's you could probably say is similar to Closer is, if you know, the first listen, you pick up on the probably penis references of, you know, how to get so big, how to get so strong, how'd you get so hard, how'd you get so long, but then you peel back those layers and there's more underneath. And this one you really have to dig. It's a lot harder to interpret these distorted lyrics versus Closer.
Yeah, it's definitely it's a little bit harder to pin down. I feel like if you actually read the lyrics of those pre-choruses, you know, the parts that are damn near impossible to hear, it lends a lot more context to the verses in the chorus. It makes them seem a little bit less trite. So rather than doing a poetic reading of those lyrics here on the podcast, I guess we'll encourage you, the listeners, to go check them out on your own time.
Next, we have The Becoming.
So with The Becoming, I don't have as much to say, but maybe Tyler, you do. In general, it seems like the character's coming to grips with his actions and the effect that they've had on him. Like, he's actually finally starting to really think about the consequences. But that's pretty much all I got.
I've always felt like this is kind of like, and maybe this doesn't necessarily fit in with the story, the album story, but if it always seemed like there was some kind of machine that the character is fighting. That's the machine is something that's deep down inside of him, and it sounds like it might actually fit in with some of the concepts that you've been talking about so far. Mm-hmm. But this thing that has been slowly growing within him and trying to slowly take control from the inside, and the character has been fighting it, and then this is kind of when the machine really gets to take hold and, you know, take control. And then there's a part towards the end where it kind of almost goes, I know it's not really an acoustic guitar, but it kind of feels that vibe of kind of that calm. And it's almost like there's a brief moment where the main character is able to kind of reassert control and kind of plead for himself and plead out to Annie, this character that gets named. And then the machine takes back its control. That's how I always kind of heard it as.
I really like that because, that steps outside of me trying to cram it into that framework of, you know, all of this German philosophy and whatever. But in an interesting way, that does fit in. It's just in a more artistic way to describe it, right? You know, it's this sort of mechanical virus eating away at the inside of him, you know, affecting his...
Yeah,
his compassion, you know, his human feeling,
and maybe my knowledge of later Nine Inch Nails works kind of influenced that my viewpoint on that. But I do think that kind of idea of like some kind of internal machine or some internal virus or something comes up later in other Nine Inch Nails tracks.
And then also, side note, the Annie that he's referencing in there. He mentioned that in an interview with the alternative press and said that Annie was abstractly referring to a college sweetheart heartbreak situation that at the time, it happened at the time that he was writing the song, and it was a valid source of emotional pain to draw from. And he went on to say her real name is Andrea Mulrain and her phone number is redacted. So I don't know, been reading that caught my attention because I thought that was pretty funny.
I feel like since this interview happened like, you know, 20 years later, it probably isn't even her
real
name.
It was 10 years later.
That's
but he's making stuff up maybe.
That's Trent's level of humor. Yeah, that's I think that's Trent's humor. It's don't take everything literally. I think that's another thing that fans do is they'll take every word that Trent says as literal. The next song is I Do Not Want This. I feel like this is a good follow-up to The Becoming because, you know, if we're still trying to wedge my machine virus interpretation idea, you know, the first line is I'm losing ground. So I you know, maybe there's a little bit of a follow-up or a connection there.
Yeah.
I guess in terms of the lyrics, they seem kind of like the old school Pretty Hate Machine, like, you know, don't tell me how I feel kind of a thing, but it seems more mature in the way it's presented
here.
Yeah,
in a weird way, the lyrics are kind of simplistic, but they are very earnest. You know, going into that whole, you know, the journey down through him trying to, you know, become an Ubermensch or whatever. And at some point, he realizes that along the way, he lost himself and is not really happy with where it has taken him. And he's realizing that for the first time. And, you know, as I mentioned in the, you know, in my essay, the music is very unsettling, and I feel like it you know, kind of perfectly underlies just how messed up of an emotion he is describing, you know?
I do feel like the last four lines or so talk about that kind of Übermensch idea that you were talking about, where people would take the concepts and pervert them. You know, I want to know everything. I want to be everywhere. I want to fuck everyone in the world. I want to do something that matters. At some point, most people felt some or all of those things. What am I supposed to do in the world?
Mm-hmm. It's one of those things that strikes me that Trent may not have been such a productive member of society if he hadn't had music as an outlet.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's definitely an interesting idea, and you know, not just for Trent, but there's a lot of people, I think, that if they didn't have music as an outlet or some other thing as an outlet. So the next song around the corner is A Big Man with a Gun. Yeah. I'll kind of jump in at the beginning here. This is probably my least favorite song on the album, just because it's so in your face and it's so unsettling. I've just never really been able to enjoy it, if that makes sense.
So I definitely hear that. It's you know, I've joked before about certain lyrics of Trent's not being subtle, but this one really isn't.
Wait, Brian, hang on. Let me read you a line here and tell me that this is not a subtle line that's like an onion that needs to be unraveled slowly to feel all the meanings of. I got me a big old dick, and I like to have fun.
Okay, challenge accepted here. In this song, the gun and the dick are the same thing. Right? The gun is a metaphor for the dick is a metaphor for the gun, and this song, in a very major way, is indicative of what many people today describe as toxic masculinity, right? The link between being masculine and being violent, right? And, you know, this is going again into that id territory, right? I'm unrestricted. I will go. I'll fight. I'll fuck. I'll kill. I'll do whatever I want, right? I'll do whatever I damn well please, because I'm a man, damn it. Right? And I feel like that is the crux of this song, and I feel like it is so extremely tongue-in-cheek that it gets away with it. Now, that being said, I'm never going to sit down and be like, man, I really want to listen to Big Man with a Gun, but I do feel like it offers some interesting social commentary that seems very, very relevant with some of the discussions that are being had in 2018 now. That's why he's got a big old dick, Tyler.
But why is it an old dick? Well,
it's not so much old, it's just it's big ol', you know? Like, it's a big old dick.
It's, yeah, big, like, ol'.
There's
okay.
Apostrophe
okay.
on there,
so
you
must
know?
Be a typo. Okay. gotcha.
I wish we could go through that again with more straight faces.
But no, I mean, in all seriousness, I have the lyrics in front of me, and you, as I sarcastically brought this up, and you totally jumped with it and gave me a real answer with my sarcasm, and with the lyrics in front of me, I feel like your analysis is right on. I mean, there's a line that I'm hard as fucking steel. I've got some power. I mean, in that one line, he's hard, but it's also you get the phallic reference and you have the gun reference all in one line. There's not a lot of lyrics in this song, but I feel like you're on the right track with what
you're
saying.
Well, and, you know, I feel like, you know, not to get into the gun control debate, but I feel like some people have been making the argument that for certain subsets of the population, a gun is sort of a prosthetic dick, right? You know, it's a way to cover up insecurities.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we've all seen giant trucks on the freeway.
Yes, yep. And we've all seen trucks with truck nuts on them.
Our next stop on our tour is A Warm Place.
Warm Place is interesting. There's no lyrics to the song. It's a perfectly instrumental song, and you know, it shares a lot of bones with the David Bowie song Crystal Japan, but it's got its own sound. It's unique. You know, the structure is different. But what purpose does it serve in the album? And I would say that it's you know, it's a place of catharsis, right? So if you follow the track through where he's been doing this consistent, you know, downward journey through the becoming, and I do not want this, and then, you know, at this point the machine's taken over him, and he's Big Man with a Gun, right? That's where he's arrived.
Yeah.
And maybe A Warm Place is he finally has an honest moment of reflection. Maybe I do not want this was this weird, you know, back-and-forth struggle he was having. Now, he's finally arrived at damn near rock bottom, and he's having a moment of looking back, and, you know, I don't really know if that's what it is, though. That's the only way that I've been able to make sense of this track. but it almost sounds too happy for that.
It's definitely a place that's calm and kind of, you know, giving you a chance to kind of look back on, or giving the main character a chance to look back on everything that's happened so far. One thing that I have noticed is, Brian, I'm sure you're like me, where you've heard the downward spiral in its entirety in different parts multiple times over and over again, backwards and forwards. And so a lot of times, some of the emotional places that the album is supposed to take you on are, you've been through the ride a few times, and so you know all the turns and bends and stuff, so they don't hit you as hard. I would challenge somebody who's in that place to go on a nice long car ride with somebody who's not a fan of Nine Inch Nails or this album, and don't talk to them and play this album really loud. And by the time you get to a warm place, you'll have all this tension that's built up, especially through a big man with a gun. And then when you get to a warm place, you almost physically exhale and just like, oh, okay, we can rest, yeah. We can calm down, you know. I don't have to worry about this song. Okay, here we are. And I feel like that's the point of this
song.
Yeah,
well, and it's almost sort of, if you think of it as a film, right, as a movie with a three-act structure, it's almost an intermission before the last act, you know? But, mm-hmm. You know, I wish I had a better answer for what I think this song means for the character, but I think it does mean something to Trent, and that may be a secret he'll take to his grave.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and maybe it's just because the next song is Eraser, and that, you know, that's a song that has a nice slow build, and maybe the point of A Warm Place is to go from the in your face from A Big Man with a Gun, and it's like, okay, let's slow it down, let's pump the brakes a little bit, get you to a place where Eraser will have a bigger impact. Because if you removed A Warm Place and you went from A Big Man with a Gun, where it's nice and loud, and then all of a sudden it just drops and then slowly starts reinserting the layers and building up again, it won't have the same effect.
Yeah, you wouldn't have enough time to recover. You'd be still numb from, you know, the previous, what, eight songs? Yeah, no, maybe it serves more of an album function necessarily than a story function, but all that being said, it's a gorgeous piece of music. I think Warm Place is one of the prettiest songs that Trent has ever made, with the possible exception of some stuff on Ghosts, in terms of just music that is made for the sake of being beautiful music rather than telling a story.
That is definitely one of the potential explanations, Brian.
All right, maybe I can sleep easier now.
Probably not, because the next song is Eraser.
Oh, shit.
I am a big fan of Eraser. I really like that it is... And correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like every instrument on this track comes in one at a time. So you've got just that, might be bass, might be synth, that starting out, you know, do-do-do-do-do-do.
That sound at the beginning?
Yeah, sorry, I forgot about that sound. But yeah, just that you definitely have the weird, whatever those...
It sounds like flies?
Yeah, you're a little unsettled. Everything is looping over and over, and another layer gets put on top, and another layer gets put on top, and another layer puts on top, and until you have the whole song, every piece is in place. And there's just something about that is just really cool.
And he really takes his time with it. Like, he spends a good solid four minutes just getting you ready for the song proper. You know, maybe if A Warm Place was the exhale, maybe this is the, you know, the long inhale to prepare for the ending. But what's kind of interesting is
he
spends all that time building it up, and then when it finally hits, you know, its crescendo, it doesn't hold there, right? It drops down to, you know, a very quiet piano-driven part, and, like, the drums are, like, neutered, right? When the drums first come in, there are these, like, big... bombastic, heavily reverbed, 80s sounding bum bum kappa bum ka. But when it gets to that point, it sounds, you know, like it's being played on paper bags, you know. But all the structure's still there. He just sucks all the air out of it, and then when it finally comes down to the, you know, the use me, break me, kill me, you know, whatever those lyrics are, he just then takes it up several notches past where the build ended. Like, it's playing with your emotions and expectations. It's a really, really well put together song.
This is one song where, if in the narrative, I'm not sure exactly what's going on other than just this kind of, you know, unsettlingness to it. But I mean, it ends with the screaming and, you know, almost like going into distorted lyric of just you kill me
over and over again. Yeah.
Well, I mean, the song itself, I think is, if I had to pick one, probably my favorite on the record. You know, it's just one of the most musically interesting. It's in its weird time signature. It just really takes its time. It's also the simplest lyrically. It has with the exception of A Warm Place, which has none, the least lyrics of any song on this record. Extremely impactful, in spite of that, because of the way he delivers it.
Yeah, definitely. I do think that I would agree with you, and if I had to pick one song, I think I would go with Eraser. But we're done talking about Eraser, because we're going to talk about Reptile.
Ooh, Reptile.
Reptile is like, it's almost like a companion to Closer. It's the, you know, the Closer's that openly we're going to talk about sex song. But this one is like, all right, we're going to, you know, we were talking about sex. Now we're going to do sex.
Yeah. And, you know, I feel like the subject matter and the attitude are not that different between the two songs. You know, one might say that, you know, maybe they're two sides of the same coin, like, you know, Closer is cocaine and Reptile is heroin, if you will.
Well, now I need to do research, Brian. I'll be right back.
And then we never heard from Tyler again. Some say he's still out there researching till this day.
But no, I mean, I definitely think it's something similar. I think that, you know, Closer is more talking about the concepts and the idealistic, more idealistic thing. And then Reptile is like, all right, I'm going to go in, you know, I'm in an alley. Everything is dirty and smells and this is more the physical.
Yeah. No, I think there's something to be said for that. I think it's, really interesting sort of the opposition in some of the words that he uses, just even within one sentence in this song, right? You know, he took the time to lovingly craft this song with some, like, really genuinely insulting language, right? Like the, oh, my beautiful liar, oh, my precious whore, right? Like, you know, there are these really weird sort of, I don't want to say oxymoronic, but very, very, like, conflicting statements. And I feel like that lends a lot of the gravity that the song has. But so some of the imagery that he paints, like the first line is where she spreads herself wide open to let the insects in. I can't tell if he loves this person or despises this person or both.
Kind of later on in the lyrics, no matter what he thinks of this person, he kind of puts himself in the same category, you know, whether that's on a pedestal or down below, kind of a thing, you know, where the devil speak of the way in which he'll manifest, and then he talks about himself of angels bleed from the tainted touch of my caress. No matter what, he feels like, for better or worse, he's in the same league as this person. This song definitely sets a mood, and even though it's about sex, it's probably not one that you want to have sex to.
Yeah, I guess it depends on what you're into, but I sure wouldn't.
The song The Downward Spiral is next.
This is one of those places where that downward spiral motif actually comes back. It is the same sort of melody as is played at the end of Closer, but it's in a different key, and this time instead of being on a piano, it's played on a guitar. Yeah, you know, and it's got a different effect to it. It's also played much slower, but it's there, and that's more or less how it starts. But then it's sort of a spoken word delivery, right? It's almost like a jam poetry piece.
and a lot of those lyrics are kind of, you know, hidden. You kind of have to really listen. You have to listen to it with intent.
And for me, this is not one of the songs where that bothered me. And I think part of that is just because of how heavy the lyrics are. I feel like there's actually, it's worthwhile to be able to absorb these ones more slowly. Because frankly, this song is, It's messed up, you know. It's actually dealing with this character very seriously contemplating suicide. I think it's worth taking in slowly rather than all at once.
So Brian, a lot of people are split on. Do you think the character in the story Does he commit suicide in the song or even in the album itself? Or is it just contemplation? Or does that even matter?
Well, I think one could definitely make the argument that it doesn't matter. But my thinking is that the lyrics make it pretty clear that he kills himself in this song. And that's the way I read it.
Yeah, that's how I've always read it as well. Well, that wasn't interesting at all. We need to disagree about something.
The imagery is very graphic, right? Like, the long starts off, like, you know, the song starts off, he couldn't believe how easy it was. He put the gun into his face, bang. Like, it's relatively clear to me, right, at that point.
Yes.
And that's the first three lines of the song. But, you know, I guess some people's arguments might hinge around the fact that there is one more song. But I see, you know, the last song is being, you know, whether it be an epilogue to the story, I see it as being sort of a goodbye letter, sort of honestly a suicide letter.
There's not much to talk about there. It's very straightforward.
So. I feel like that makes it worth mentioning that there was once going to be a song on this album called Just Do It, somewhere around this part of the story, that apparently was more directly urging the character to kill himself. And apparently the producer wanted nothing to do with it. And what I find interesting about that is that this song is very dark and very graphic. So what was going on in that song if this one was okay and that one wasn't? But I guess it's a mystery we'll never quite know the answer to, because the song was, to my knowledge, never recorded or released.
All right, let's move on to the last song, and it is Hurt. Another iconic song, I think.
Yeah, this song... It doesn't matter how long it's been. This song will always affect me in one way or another.
You know, I listened to Nine Inch Nails for years and years before I ever had a chance to see them live. And I understood the song's place and point for this album. But for years, Nine Inch Nails has ended pretty much every show with Hurt. And so I've heard live versions of it. You know, many, many bootlegs and, you know, official live albums and stuff. It always seemed kind of anticlimactic to, you know, for me, I always want to end on like a super high note, super loud, like, you know, a rock song kind of a thing. But it wasn't until I actually heard it live in person, like hearing a tape of it didn't affect me, but standing there and listening to it live made me go, oh, now I get it.
I think for me, the thing that that sort of changed me on this song, because I have not yet been lucky enough to see Nine Inch Nails play live, and that'll change sometime soon, I'm sure. But the thing that changed it for me was actually hearing Johnny Cash's cover and being able to look past, you know, the sort of gritty layers that Trent put on the song. And see more of just what's actually at the core, like the germ of the song, without all of the excess. And that actually made me like the original much better than I ever did. When I was younger, I would get to Hurt and I'd be like, oh, God, that was the slow one, right?
The album's over. Everybody go home.
If I had to pick only one song that I could listen to on this record, it'd be a real tough one between this and Eraser. Hurt is just sort of transcendent. Mm-hmm. So, but not to sound like a complete nerd, but you know, at the end of season two of Rick and Morty, right, when they play this song as Rick is turning himself into the cops, I was sitting there like, why the hell am I almost crying at a cartoon? And the answer is because of that song, right? It would not have had the impact without it. There is something transcendent about this song. It works in just about any context.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I don't really know what else I can kind of add to it. It's just such a great little song. So one thing that I do want to mention, and it's a little self-serving because we were able to interview somebody related to this, but in 2014 there was a set of remixes that came out that were basically lost, kind of like lost remixes that were rediscovered and kind of polished a bit and released for fans.
The general idea here is that primarily a gentleman by the name of Danny Hyde, who was a long-term collaborator with the band Coil and had worked on a number of remixes for Nine Inch Nails. When he found himself with some free time, dug into his old recordings and found some previously unreleased remix material for Nine Inch Nails, and took the time to finish it up, polish it out, and put it to the masses.
We were able to reach out, and we were able to talk to Danny Hyde himself, and that will be a kind of a special episode that will come out. You know, we release monthly. It'll come out, you know, halfway through this current month, and so we hope you enjoy it. Something that we have this month for this episode is we actually have a listener comment and thought.
Oh, no way.
A thought on the album. This comes from Sam Clark, and he posted on our Facebook. I love the darkness and heaviness of the Downward Spiral. I like the way the album flows. The tracks complement each other. It has a cohesion, which is enhanced by the Downward Spiral melody motif that reoccurs throughout the album. I love the unorthodox time signatures, the sonic textures, and the attention to detail, the inventiveness of the samples, and the density of the layers and of sound that make up the tracks. I actually didn't like this album the first few times I heard it, probably because of how abrasive it is, but I kept coming back to it regardless, as I knew there was something there, and is now one of my favorite albums. Thank you, Sam, for writing all that out and posting it.
Well, I completely agree. You know, the funny thing is that this is not an album that I really have dug into and listened to a whole bunch, right? You know, I gave it a lot of tries when I was younger, but through this process of analyzing the record for the show, I have come to enjoy it more. Mm-hmm. And I think Sam's got a point that that this record, probably more so than any other Nine Inch Nails record, rewards repeat listening.
Do you want to talk about, is there a non-Nine Inch Nails album that we want to talk, kind of just recommend real quick? I think we kind of had the idea of doing a concept album themed selection.
Yeah, and I'm perfectly fine with doing concept albums. I like that. If I had to pick one, and this is difficult,
and it has to not, it's not Nine Inch Nails.
Nine Inch Nails.
Have to kind of rule those out.
But I was really hoping that I could submit my favorite Nine Inch Nails concept album, Katy Perry's Teenage Dream.
I would love your selection so much if it actually was a concept album, and I just never knew it.
So I think one of my favorite concept albums is actually going to be from the band The Proto Men. It's Act 2, The Father of Death. Are you familiar with this band at all, Tyler?
Not at all.
Okay, so what they are is it's a rock opera. And think like, you know, like 80s butt rock, like just like 80s metal rock. And, I mean, there's more mm-hmm. to it than that, but, it's that, but it is based on the story of the Mega Man video games. And it is done with
that
complete seriousness. There is no tongue in cheek. They just do it. And it is freaking beautiful. They've been waiting for like 1 billion years to put out a third album, but the second one is golden. It is absolutely fantastic.
So my pick for a really cool concept album is Black Ribbons by Shooter Jenkins and Hierophant, and it's a dystopian concept where, you know, it's the kind of it's very similar to The Stand, if you've ever read that book, where, you know, the government's kind of taken over a bit. And, you know, martial law has been is being declared, and rights are being taken away slowly, one at a time, kind of a thing. And the one of the main connections to The Stand, basically the idea is that you're listening to a radio station, and the DJ is the writer Stephen King, and he's the disc jockey who comes on between the songs and kind of tells you what's going on in the world. You know, mm-hmm. in this world, the songs that he's playing are banned songs. They're on the government's, you know, blacklist of these works should be censored,
yeah.
kind of a thing. And this is his last night on the radio, and he's going to go out with a bang. And so he's just, you know, screw it. I'm going to play all the stuff that I'm not supposed to play. And I'm going to, that's my protest. So hearing Stephen King get on and just be a DJ between the songs, that's kind of cool.
It's very cool.
Yeah, so that's my pick, and you can't make me change it. Not that you would. So one last thing before we close the show. I feel like we should talk about the Nine Inch Nails song, The Perfect Drug. Because The Perfect Drug, it's not on the Downward Spiral, and it's not on the next album that we're going to visit, the Fragile. It kind of comes out in between these two things. It shows up on the soundtrack for the Lost Highway movie, but it's something that, you know, there's a music video for it that doesn't really have anything to do with the movie, and it's just kind of this weird little island out by itself. And especially because The Fragile is such a massive undertaking, it's probably best to just mention it here.
Absolutely.
At the end of this album.
Yeah.
So I know.
It.
Yeah. It's just such a weird little song, I guess. The music video apparently was like super expensive. To film, like one of the most expensive, it was like, probably, I think it, I want to say it was like the most expensive music video of the time. It's like goth themed, or, you know, it's like Edgar Allan Poe kind of, you know, everything's dark, and it looks like Trent is a dad, and his son died. And so he turns to absinthe to kind of drown his sorrows. And it's a weird, but cool.
The music video is a little more intriguing and strange than the song itself, but the song really serves as a really great stylistic bridge between Downward Spiral and Fragile. I would say it is a perfect average of those albums from a stylistic standpoint. It's actually one of my very favorite songs of theirs. It's one I don't listen to it very often, but it's just so damned interesting. What they do with the instruments and the chord progressions and the way that they line up is really delightfully strange. But the song moves so fast that it keeps your attention anyway. It's very unique.
Yeah, and I know that Trent is not very satisfied with it. I think it was kind of a thing of he was like obligated to write something and make something. So he made this song, and then a couple years later, he was, you know, there was time to put out The Fragile, and he intentionally chose not to include it in The Fragile in any form. If you haven't heard the song, maybe pause it real quick and give it a listen. But the drum solo towards the end is apparently very complex.
So with the solo, it's a combination of an actual drum part, but for the most part, it's a bunch of samples layered over each other. One of the most prominent there being a really famous sample that's been used in hundreds of songs, known as the Amen Break. Special shout out to our producer Arthur for that piece of research. But yeah, it's the Amen Break. And you can just type Amen Break into Google, and it will give you a documentary on how that works. But it was from an old sort of funk soul song called Amen Brother. And it was performed by the soul band The Winstons. And it's just this really great drum beat that has then been used as a foundational beat for a lot of hip hop, been used in a lot of remixes, and then eventually in a Nine Inch Nails song as part of a blistering drum solo.
That's really interesting. I've never heard of this before. I'll have to check that out. That's really cool.
Yeah. There's a whole, you know, Wikipedia article on it. Just Amen Break. Well, that is just about going to wrap us up for this month's episode. Tyler, where can they find us?
Well, our email is discographers@gmail.com. We have a Facebook account. We have Facebook. We have Twitter. We have a Patreon if you wanted to support us, throw us a couple bucks. We have a few little things that we can kind of give you in return as a thanks for supporting us. And you can listen to us, you know, everywhere you can find podcasts, and you can hear us on SoundCloud as well. And make sure and check out the next episode in our feed. It will be the Danny Hyde interview. I know Brian and I both had a lot of fun chatting with him, and it was definitely a cool behind the scenes look at some of the remixes of the Downward Spiral and kind of behind the scenes of how some remixes are made in general.
Thank you very much for spending some time with us on this new extra large episode of the Discographers, and we hope you'll join us next time. Have a great month. You are the perfect drug.